Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Welcome to the Easter service for Timonium United Methodist Church. We're glad that you're here to worship with us on this most holy of worship services of the year.
Happy Resurrection Day. Do we have any announcements? Are there any announcements at all, other than the fact that Rob Johns is having kebabs available outside after the service? So help yourself to those. Join with me in the mission statement, if you would, please. Celebrate God's love. Share it with everyone. Make disciples of Christ.
Thank you.
The call to worship this morning is from the 118th Psalm, verses 1, 2, and 14 through 20. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my power. The Lord has become my salvation. There are joyous songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me sorely, but has not given me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. Let us pray. Almighty God, through Jesus Christ you overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life. Grant that we, who celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection, may, by the renewing of your Spirit, arise from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Before we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, we're asking if anyone has any special prayer requests we can add. Oh, hi, go ahead.
Alan Pastrana.
Alan Pastrana?
Pastrana.
Okay. You're welcome. Anybody else?
Any special praises today? Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this wonderful occasion when we celebrate the coming back of your Son from the dead, his resurrection. Lord, we pray for Alan. We pray for all those who need a special touch by reason of illness. We pray especially for those with COVID, and we pray, Lord, for their families and for their caregivers. Lord, we know that we are winning this battle, but there are still many who are suffering and many who are grieving loss. And Lord, we just pray for your continued blessing of the work of doctors and scientists as we combat this disease. Lord, we pray for those who are lonely and depressed in this day. Lord, we pray that the joy of Christ would come into their heart. All this we pray through Christ our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen.
The initial scripture this morning is from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. The Gentiles hear the good news. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and of the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The gospel this morning is taken from Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. Please rise as you are able. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of them to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And all that had been commanded of them, they told briefly to those around Peter. And afterward, Jesus himself sent through them from east to west a sacred and imperishable proclamation of eternal salvation. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Gracious God, I pray that today you would give me the words that will bring peace to hearts and hope and joy. In the name of Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. Amen. So a public school teacher was a Christian, and she wanted to share her faith with her students, but the policy was that you couldn't do that. But you could ask them what they thought. And so, the week before the spring break, which used to be called the Easter break, but is now called the spring break, she asked her students, "Well, what does Easter mean?" And one student said, "Isn't that the day we dress up and go around and get candy?" No, that's, I think you're thinking of Halloween. Another student said, "Is that the day when a guy in a red suit flies around and gives everybody presents?" "No, I think you're thinking of Christmas." Worried that this wasn't going to work out, a little girl raised her hand and she said, well, Jesus walked the earth a long time ago, and he taught people, and he did wonderful things, and he helped people a lot, and then he died, sadly, on the cross, and then 3 days later, he came back to life. And the teacher said, oh, that's great, that's fantastic, so I'm so glad you know this story. He said, yeah, and so, you know, he comes out of the tomb, and you know, then if he sees a shadow, then we have 6 more weeks of winter. There are lots of ways to share the story of Easter, and that has been shared thousands and millions of times. And there's good ways, and there's not as good ways to share that gospel message. Now, we have recorded a story about it in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Usually, I preach on one of those four tellings of it. We had Mark read for you today. But Acts also has this story in a briefer form. And sometimes Acts does a really good job of that. The whole Old Testament is kind of summarized in the speech of Stephen, for instance. If you want to just grab the cliff notes of the Old Testament, it's there in the speech of Stephen in Acts. And so we have Jesus being proclaimed by Peter, the chief of the apostles. And of course, now that Jesus is, you know, risen and ascended, he's in charge. So a guy calls for him, and this is not a Jew. This is somebody from outside of his comfort zone. It's always difficult to share your faith across those kinds of cultural barriers. So Peter, I'm sure, was struggling with what to say, and well, he comes up with this sermon or speech. He starts it off like this: I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. So he starts out by talking about the universality of the message, that this isn't just for Jews, as he had once personally assumed that it was, but now he's kind of preaching to himself, hey, you know, the doors are blown off of this message. This message is for everybody. And so he starts off by proclaiming, first to himself and then to those who are listening, hey, this message about Jesus is for everybody. No matter where you are, no matter what nation you come from, this message has power. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. He assumes Cornelius, the guy he's talking to in his household, knew something, or they wouldn't have called for him in the first place, because Peter was invited to tell his story and also, you know, to invite them into the faith. And the way that he describes Jesus' ministry here is interesting. He starts out by talking about what Jesus preached, peace. Now, that's a word that was as much needed back then as it is today. Peace is so much more than merely the absence of fighting war. Peace is this solid foundation on which our lives can rest. It is possible to have peace with God through Jesus Christ and his sacrifice. It is possible to have peace with others because we know that God loves and values everyone and all of their opinions and continues to reach out to everyone and never gives up on anyone. If we can hold that sort of strength in our hearts too, we'll have peace with everyone. So far as it depends on us. And then peace within ourselves, that too is very important. It's so hard to have joy or happiness without that peace. Now you can have a fleeting happiness. It might come to you, just fall out of the sky. Good thing happens, lucky thing happens, but it doesn't last. Not unless there's a foundation of peace, where we are not struggling with ourselves all the time, and not fearful all the time, and there's so many struggles in this world. Peace, that is what Jesus preached. Preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. And that kind of sums it up. I mean, why can we have peace? Because Jesus is in charge. Because there's a plan. Because no matter how bad things get, we still win because of the resurrection and the fact that we take part in that resurrection along with Jesus and his being the first fruits, the one that came back first. It proves to the rest of us that no matter how bad it gets, we still come out on top, those of us who have this connection. And this connection is something that will help us through the toughest of times when we remember that Jesus is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. He brings in John the Baptist briefly, and I think the reason was because Cornelius wanted to be baptized and, you know, enter into the faith. And Easter was a day in which people were baptized back in the early church. That for centuries, you would spend almost an entire year preparing yourself for baptism. And it was supposed to be life-changing, transforming. You were supposed to be buried in water and then raised again to newness of life. It was supposed to be transformative, just as Easter is supposed to be transformative for all of us. So this moment of baptism was terribly important. Now, baptism can mean different things to different people at different times, but at this time, for Cornelius, the guy who's listening to this message in his household, well, it means a commitment to the teachings that Peter is bringing him about Jesus. It means crossing over from death and sin to life and joy and peace. Now, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Now, he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. Now, that's a pretty short synopsis of Jesus' ministry. Just really, you know, one long sentence to tell everything that he did. Now, you're supposed to, if you were a reader of the book of Acts, you're supposed to have read the book of Luke first. There's kind of, there are two bookends, and the same guy wrote both of them. So, of course, there's a longer iteration of Jesus' ministry. But if you're going to get it down to a capsule, just, you know, a short message of what he did, it's this. Jesus of Nazareth was anointed with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. See, we too have God with us. So we too can do these deeds of power. And, you know, when you think about the tremendous miracles that Jesus did, well, that's not mentioned here. It doesn't mention, you know, feeding of 5,000. Well, we can't do that. We can't open the eyes of the blind. There's a lot of things that Jesus did that seem to be well beyond our scope of ministry. But we all have this opportunity to heal those who are oppressed by the devil. Oppression is definitely very real today. And you come across people who are oppressed all the time, oppressed by loneliness, oppressed by depression, oppressed by illness, oppressed by systemic injustice, oppressed by all kinds of different prejudices and things like that. Those oppressions, they destroy ability for people to have peace and joy. And we as Christians have a message that should overcome that, that says that all people are equally valuable, that you will win. There is a victory because of what Jesus did on the cross, and because he came back from the dead, it proves that victory to be true, that we always have hope. There is no way that hope can be taken away from us if we believe that the resurrection is true, if we believe that Jesus was the man that the scriptures say that he was. There is always hope. And when there is that hope, it destroys oppression. Oppression fears hope. You know, when those try to oppress others, one of the things they've got to take away is hope, because if they don't, people keep coming back. They keep fighting. And until you can destroy hope, you can't really take away people's freedom. And so with hope comes this sense of peace, and then from that peace comes joy, and then power, and the ability to overcome the oppression. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. And so Peter talks about being a witness. And that's so important that people talk about how Jesus impacted them. What does it mean to me? Because it is an old story now. And if we just consider it to be something that happened a really long time ago, it's not very relevant to today. But when we are witnesses to it, when we have seen how God can move in my life, in your life, in the lives of other people that you've seen, you know it's real. You know it's powerful. You know it can transform the world. And so being a witness is very important. And that's what Peter's there to do on that day. He's trying to be a witness, trying to tell the story in such a way that, you know, Cornelius will be gripped by it, transform his life, and then follow Jesus. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. Now, you have to put that in there in order for the resurrection to make any sense. The crucifixion is the necessary precursor to the resurrection. And it is something very strange, this idea that the Messiah would be crucified. It was unthinkable to most of the people of that time. It was an injustice, and it was a terrible thing that happened. And yet, out of it, God was able to bring good, because God always finds ways to bring good out of evil, out of bad circumstances. There's always a way out. And so even at the depth of suffering there, Jesus was able to find his way back, back into life through the resurrection. And we too, and all those that we know who are, you know, who are close to the heart of God, well, they will all find this life again in the resurrection. And so we can keep being victorious in this life. We can keep knowing that we can move forward. God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, waited and drank with him after he rose from the dead. So he then mentions the resurrection as the, you know, the crowning teaching of what Christianity is all about. It's the end of the story of Jesus in one sense, and the beginning of the new story of Jesus in another sense, how Jesus is now universal, how Jesus continues to live, not like the prophets of many other religions who, well, they may have been great men or women, their teachings, came to an end when they ceased to live, and therefore those faiths go on in a different way. Our faith is led by one who continues to live among us, because Jesus can live in our hearts. We can have this connection to Christ that allows us to continue to proclaim him in strength and power, and to continue to hold on to peace and to joy. There is this celebration that can go on in our lives because Christ was raised from the dead. This is a powerful moment in the world's history when death no longer won against everybody. Before that, it was just supposed, you know, you lived a certain amount of time and that was it. Maybe you could live on through children or grandchildren or something like that, but now there is this inheritance that goes on and on and on. And through Christ, we know that we have a part of that inheritance. And so our love, our grace can continue to push through all of those problems that come around us. And there's going to be problems in this world. Jesus didn't promise us that it would stop, that there wouldn't be any more problems. He said, in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And he overcomes the world through the cross and then through the resurrection. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. And so he takes this gospel and he applies it to Peter himself, and then to his audience, that this is the way that we can receive forgiveness of sins, that those problems that we have had, those difficulties, those failures we've had in the past, they don't have to control us anymore. They can be pushed aside. They don't have to have any power. Christ died on the cross for our sins, and we, if we accept this forgiveness, well, now we can push those aside from ourselves. We no longer have to be under that call, that death of sin. We now have a chance for freedom. And this freedom comes through Christ. This freedom comes through our belief and our hope that Christ has overcome sin through the cross and death through the resurrection. And this power will be able to take us to whatever places we need to go in this world and to testify as we go along about the power of who Jesus is and how he can apply to our lives and how can he apply to the lives of all those that we come in contact with. Let us go forth in joy, preaching the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. receive now the benediction. May this story of the resurrection give you a sense of peace, a foundation upon which you can build in hope towards joy. May you share this victorious message with all those that you come in contact with. And may you bring many into an understanding of who Jesus was, his death on the cross for their sins, and his raising to newness of life to show us the way to a life here that is abundant and a life forever.